This conference will now be recorded.
All right. So hi everyone, my name is Dr. Bhavna Sharma. I work as a medical registrar in the NHS and I'm soon to start my endocrinology job. What we're going to do today is we're going to focus on OET speaking, in particular because OET speaking is an exam which is for medical professionals. I'll try and tailor this sort of scenario or this session in medical language, because working as a doctor, you tend to be a little more oriented to what's expected on the OET, in particular the OET speaking session. What I'll do today is I'll try and cover the common points due to which people fail on the OET speaking, because we've got lots and lots of sessions and lots of lectures and YouTube videos online which just talk about OET speaking, its criteria, and they give you some scenarios. But the testing, especially in Teachio, we've sort of got an idea of what the common mistakes are that tend to be quite repetitive across the students that we test. So I've sort of made a cheat sheet today, which highlights the common points where most people make mistakes on. And then we'll try and cover different mistakes and see how we can improve them and sort of solve the problem of failing on OET speaking. Hema, if you cannot see, you need to set your meeting to viewing people who are talking, so that way you should be able to see my screen. All right. So everyone knows that on the OET speaking, you are evaluated on. Okay. Guys, please make sure that your mic is off, because then it just sort of interferes with the sound. All right. So everyone knows that on the OET speaking, you are evaluated on two assessment criteria, which are your clinical communication criteria and your linguistic criteria. So your clinical communication criteria is similar to what is expected on the PLAB and the MRCP basis as well. It is relevant to nurses as well, because this is very, very similar to what your life will be when you come and work as a doctor or a nurse in the NHS, or for the matter, any foreign country that you're going to go to. The linguistic criteria is more specific to the OET in general. So that's basically evaluating your language and evaluating your grammar and pronunciation. So that's more of an English test, and your clinical communication criteria is more of what basic clinical communication working in the NHS would be. So what I'll try and do is now I'll talk about the various criteria which are on the official OET website. If you don't have the scoring criteria with you, we'll send you a PDF with the official OET scoring criteria, but you can find it on the website as well. We'll talk about the linguistic criteria first and the mistakes that people make on each and every linguistic criteria section. So the first section, which is evaluated on your linguistic criteria, is intelligibility. So intelligibility basically means, on what they've written on the website, is the impact of your pronunciation, intonation and accent on how the listener can understand you. So intelligibility basically means whether the person in front of you can understand your English. Now, what the common mistakes which happen and which make you score lower on intelligibility is, first of all, if you have a very, very strong accent. Remember, the OET exam is an exam which was developed in Australia, and it's mostly evaluated in Australia. So definitely your accent won't be an Australian accent. We have people from all around the world who give this exam. So they don't want you to have a particular accent. So they don't expect you to have an Australian accent. But what they want is, even if you have an accent, are people able to understand you? What I find a lot of students doing is that they actually fake an accent. So they try and think that trying to copy an English accent or an American accent is going to make you pass the OET speaking. What happens when you do this is, first of all, you come out of your comfort zone. So you're already doing one thing which is fake. Now, trying to do this in an environment which is unfamiliar, you're going to lose marks on your clinical communication criteria and your linguistic criteria in general, because you are out of your comfort zone and you're faking something. So your focus will be only on that accent. So this is a very, very common point which people fail on. Please do not try to fake something. Try to use your normal English. But that being said, if you have a very, very strong accent, try and speak a little slower and try and intone your words. What that means is, a common mistake that a lot of people do is, especially this scenario comes up a lot when you're supposed to give your patient a local anesthetic. So try and intone the term anesthetic very, very carefully. So you're going to say anesthetic so that your patient can understand you. What a lot of people do is that they try and speak very fast. They have a very strong accent. So the term anesthetic comes in range. Guys, please make sure that your mic is off when you join in. Especially when we have a number of common medical terms. For example, anesthesia, anesthesiologist, and anesthetic. So there are three different words. So if you intone your words, or you sort of stretch out the words which are a little complex, then your listener will be able to understand you. Guys, try to go through the common medical terms, terms like diabetologist, endocrinologist, cardiologist. Try and revise the common medical terms and make sure that your pronunciation is understandable. Examination, on examination. So try and go through common medical terms. What we'll do, we'll send you a PDF of, if you send us your email address, if you email teachyouracademy@gmail.com, we'll send you a PDF of common medical terms which come up on the OET speaking. And then you can sort of revise your pronunciation. It'll just make your life a little easier, because I find a lot of students messing up common medical terms. If you expect them to come in your exam, why not just revise your accent and your intonation before you give your actual exam? So that might be a little helpful, especially on scoring on the intelligibility section. Moving on, fluency. Now, fluency is written on the OET website as the impact of your speed and smoothness on your listener's understanding. I often find that people do not really revise the OET speaking before they come and give their exam. So they're basically just focused on the OET writing and reading. Yes, they are slightly more difficult than the OET speaking, but you still need to practice this before you come to your actual exam. When you don't practice your OET speaking, what I advise people to do is, before their test, just try and revise with people who are giving the exam with you, or try and use medical English, or try and speak to your patients in English, or try and speak to your colleagues in English, so that the hesitancy, or if you don't have enough confidence, you're going to have a lot of gaps in your speaking. If you haven't practiced, you'll have a lot of gaps when you're sort of going like, I mean, so if you do a lot of this, you're going to lose marks on your fluency section. So what happens is, first of all, you're going to lose marks on your fluency section, and then the examiner might think that your English is so bad that you're thinking about words a lot. So you can't really understand the words, and that's why you have all of those gaps. So practice before you actually perform on your OET speaking. I find a lot of people have a number of verbal tics. So what verbal tics mean is that there is a certain word that you repeat a lot in a conversation. Common examples are, you know. So a lot of people use you know a lot in their conversation. They use terms like and, now. So if you use this a lot in your OET speaking, if you say, you know, I think you have diabetes, you know, diabetes is related to having a high sugar, you know, high sugar can be bad. So that sort of creates a very bad impression in front of your examiner. So what I advise people to do is, when you practice your OET speaking, if you don't have a partner, try and record yourself on your phone and try and play it back. Guys, you just need to make sure that if you're using a mic, then you need to take that out of your laptop, because you won't be able to hear me. Asha, what you need to do is, you need to turn your speaker volume up and just check your settings. All right, we're just having a little bit of issues with sound. We'll just check that. All right. Okay, going back, we were just talking about verbal tics. So a lot of people do this quite a lot. When they get nervous, they try and repeat things a lot. Some people, they repeat, I'm sorry, a lot. So what they'll do is, every sentence that they do, they sort of preface that with, I'm sorry. So I'm sorry that this is happening. I'm sorry you have diabetes. I'm sorry that you're unwell. So lots of people, you know, they mistake sympathy for saying I'm sorry again and again. So just make sure that if you're using a word quite a lot, you try and avoid that. Lots of people, they repeat like a lot. So like diabetes is very important, like diabetes needs to be managed, you know, like. So you know and like are very common verbal tics, and they need to be avoided. So make sure that we do that. Gaps in conversations. Sometimes, because it's a different environment, you're in front of someone who's a stranger, and for the first time in your medical career, maybe your English is being evaluated rather than your medical language. So it's very common for people to get nervous. And what happens when you get very, very nervous? Your mind sometimes goes into a blank. So there'll be a very, very long gap in your conversation, because that's just your mind going blank and you're not knowing what to do next. What I advise my students to do is, remember that this is an English exam. This is not a medical exam. So even if you say things which might be medically wrong, if you say them in correct English, you're still going to get full marks. So just remember that, especially if you're blank. For example, if I'm talking about myocardial infarction and I'm not able to know what exactly myocardial infarction is, and I start off my conversation by saying, okay, myocardial infarction means a heart attack. A heart attack is, so then I don't really know what a heart attack is. just giving an example. Then I'm going to talk about heart attack is a very common condition. Unfortunately, sometimes a heart attack can be lethal, but most of the times we're able to save patients. So just see that I'm not really talking medical. I'm not really saying things which are medically accurate, but still I'm saying them in right English. So even though my English is fine, my medical knowledge might be a little wonky, but that's not really being assessed on OET speaking. So if you go blank, you can try and fill up those gaps with just correct sentences, and you're still going to score marks. If you're speaking accurate medical knowledge, but you have lots of gaps in your conversation, then you're going to score lower. So just, this is a handicap of the OET, but you can try and use this to your own advantage. Some people, when they think that speaking really fast is going to make you score on the OET speaking in fluency, that's incorrect. When you get very, very nervous, lots of people, they start speaking extremely fast. And what happens is that then your listener is not able to understand you, especially people who've got foreign accents. If you speak very, very fast, sometimes you lose intelligibility. So make sure that you pace your conversation. You should try and speak like you would speak to your friend in your local language. So when you speak to someone in a local language, or the way that I'm speaking right now, is for the listener to be able to understand me. I'm not going on a lecture, and I'm not trying to just go through some words just because I'm supposed to do a job. I want you guys to understand me. And that's why I'm speaking slowly and pausing my conversation. So that's actually what fluency means, is that you use your smoothness is tailored to your listener's understanding. Lots of people ask me that if we make a mistake in our grammar or we make a mistake in our sentence, should we just ignore that and move on, or should we self-correct ourselves? So even if you're a native English speaker, it's very, very possible that you make basic grammatical mistakes. For example, if I say, she are ill, okay? And then I realize, okay, I've made a grammatical mistake. Then what I can do is I can say, I'm sorry, I meant that she is ill. So if you do that, it won't really cut down your marks because you corrected your grammar immediately. So if you find that you're making grammatical mistakes, correct your sentences. Otherwise, what will happen is you'll keep on getting flustered, or you keep on getting nervous, and you'll start realizing, oh my God, I'm making so many mistakes in talking. Oh my God, I'm going to fail. So that's going to affect the conversation later on, and your speaking will start going downhill. So if you make a mistake, stop. Say, I'm sorry, and then correct yourself. All right, moving on. Another assessment criteria is appropriateness of language. So you need to make sure that the language that you're using is appropriate to your listener. I often find people, especially who are very, very senior doctors, they sort of assume that what they're saying is understood by your patient. Terms like MI, myocardial infarction, diabetes, anesthetic, IV line. So they're very common for us doctors and nurses, but for the patient to understand them is very, very difficult. For example, if you're talking about a patient's medications and you tell them that I have to give you these medications IV, you need to explain it to the patient further. You need to tell them that what IV means is basically giving medications through the vein. So if you're using a lot of complex terms, your patient won't be able to understand you. And then they might stop you and say, oh, doctor, what does that mean? Okay, so that sounds very unprofessional. This happens a lot on your PLAB and your MRCP exams as well. What happens is that if you're using a lot of difficult terms, the patient might try and stump you by saying, doctor, you're using a lot of difficult terms. I'm not really understanding what you're saying. And you know, when you've done that, your marks are going to be extremely low in clinical communication. So make sure that you're explaining everything in layman terms. Don't assume the knowledge of a patient. That being said, a lot of people over-prepare this. What I do a lot when I'm conducting mock tests, I try and switch up the scenario. For example, if this is a patient who's coming in with their child being admitted with asthma, what I'll try and do is I'll say, doctor, I'm actually a nurse, so I know a lot of asthma. And then because you're so, it's been grilled into your mind that you're supposed to explain each and everything, people start explaining IV lines to me. So they'll say, so I'm going to give you some medications now through an IV line. IV means through your vein. So I'm going to put in a cannula. Cannula is like a tube. So they'll explain everything to me. But this is a nurse. So you're basically just wasting your time and the patient's time by doing this. So just understand that your language needs to be suited to your listener. A lot of time we get scenarios where you're actually speaking to another doctor or you're speaking to another nurse. So just remember who your listener is and tailor your language to them. That being said, lots of time people get extremely nervous on their OET speaking, and then the patient starts talking about things which are distressing to the patient. For example, we had a scenario where this lady was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, and it was a new diagnosis for this lady. Or another example is that there's a young gentleman who's been diagnosed with HIV. And then, so this patient tells the doctor, doctor, do you think I'm going to die? And then the doctor, because she was very nervous, she actually laughed. She said, you don't really die of HIV. So that's extremely bad. Okay. If you do that in real life, or if you come and work with us in the NHS and you do this in front of a patient, you might lose your license. So sounding extremely casual is very bad. You need to understand that even though this is an exam and the person in front of you isn't really a patient, but you have to treat them like someone who's been diagnosed with HIV or has been diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And obviously they are very, very distressed. So be mindful of the tone that you adopt in front of your patient. Some people, especially people who've been trained in countries where possibly the doctor is treated a different way compared to the rest of the population. So doctor has sort of a high stature compared to the rest of the people. This does happen in a lot of countries. So the doctors are sort of used to a certain level of respect, or a certain, their doctors are treated like gods. So they sort of go into that thinking that the person that I'm talking to is beneath me, or they are inferior to me. So they forget that now that they're being assessed on the OET, they will be assessed on politeness. And even in real life, if you treat your patients badly, or you treat your patients like they're inferior human beings, you aren't a good doctor and you aren't a good nurse. If you're rude to your patients or you're rude to your nurses, that's going to make you an extremely bad clinician. So what I tell my students to do is you need to sound polite. So you need to, if you're telling someone to do something, for example, if you are telling this patient to take these medications, you can't tell them you need to take these medications and that's it. You're supposed to tell them, I know it can be quite difficult to take these medications each and every day and often 5 times a day. I know it can be quite a bit of a bother. I'm sorry that it's creating a bother for you, but it's very important that you take these medications because it's important for your health. So you sort of have to wrap your statements around in politeness. And if you sound a bit too rude, for example, I had this nurse, she was supposed to tell this patient that they need the blood transfusion. So they said, take this blood transfusion. So you can't do that. You're supposed to say, please, you need to do this transfusion. So just remember that your language needs to be appropriate in your tone as well as your professionalism. Resources of grammar and expression. Again, this is a linguistic criteria which is tested on your OET, and this is the part where most people fail. So on the official OET site, they talk about resources of grammar and expression mean the impact of your level of grammatical accuracy and vocabulary on your listeners' understanding. I keep repeating this again and again. This is an English exam. Even though they're testing clinical communication, this is not a medical exam. So even if you give me completely good and excellent clinical practice, if you don't use full sentences and you don't use complete grammar, you're not going to pass on the OET section. What a lot of people do is they use sentence fragments. What sentence fragments means is that so if you're talking in your local language, sometimes you don't speak full sentences. So you say, do this, I know. So using short phrases is going to cut down your marks. So if you're talking, if a patient tells you, doctor, do you know that I've been suffering from diabetes since about 15 years? And you tell the patient, I know. So that's going to be a sentence fragment. What you should do is, I know that you have been suffering from diabetes since a number of years. So see how I expanded my sentence fragment into a full sentence. This is very similar to your OET writing, where you have to paraphrase or where you're supposed to expand case notes. So try and use full sentences on your grammar section. Repetition. Lots of people, they repeat their sentences a lot. So what happens is that if they're talking about a heart attack, they keep on repeating, oh, heart attack can be very dangerous. Oh, heart attack can be very dangerous. So that's just because they are a little nervous. So they're repeating sentences a lot. But if you do that quite a number of times on your OET, they will think that your vocabulary is very less. So you have very few words that you can work with your English on. So if you want to emphasize to the patient that a heart attack can be dangerous, then you can sort of use different vocabulary. So you can say, a heart attack is dangerous. One, a heart attack can be lethal. Two, a heart attack might be detrimental to your health. Three. So see, I've said the same thing again and again, but I've used a number of different words. So that makes my OET examiner think, okay, so this person has got good vocabulary. They should get good marks on this section. Local dialect. A lot of people struggle with some words which are used in your local country. They might be English words, but they aren't proper English. One example is lots of people introduce themselves as myself, Dr. Chaudhary. So even though you think that myself is a proper word, it is not an English, it's not proper English. So you need to introduce yourself properly. You need to say, hello, I am Dr. Chaudhary. So just remember not to use your local dialect. You need to use proper English on your OET speaking. Loads and loads of people, when they get very, very nervous, they switch to their local language. Lots of people, for example, if you're a Hindi speaker, you might switch to na. Na means no in Hindi. So when they get nervous and they're talking really, really fast, then they say, I told you na. So this is a local dialect. This is not English. If you use this on your OET speaking, it's going to create a very, very bad atmosphere in front of your examiner. So just be really careful that you're not using local dialect. All right, moving on to my favorite thing, which is the clinical communication criteria. This is something that is taught to you from the first day of your nursing school or from the first day of your medical school. So this on the OET speaking, they're just repeating the things that you have been taught in your medical college, and it's very, very basic clinical communication. So don't get very, very nervous, but make sure that you go through the criteria before you attempt your exam. Lots of people think that the OET speaking is only going to be about English, and if my English is good, I'm definitely going to pass OET speaking, so I don't need to revise anything. You need to be careful that they're also looking for specific clinical communication criteria. We'll go through all of the specific criteria in this session, but remember, before going to your exam, you need to go to your official OET website and you need to check out the clinical communication criteria, because they're very, very specific. And if you don't know them, you're going to mess up and then you won't even realize why you failed on your OET speaking. So the first of all, the clinical communication criteria is relationship building. So relationship building is the impact of your choice of opening to conversation. So what that basically means is that when you go into your scenario, you're supposed to introduce yourself to your patient and you're supposed to make a note of the patient's identity. Lots of people, they just go into the scenario and they don't tell the patient their name, and then they just start off with Miss Smith, I'm going to tell you about your discharge today. Your discharge is happening today because we treated your heart attack, and now that it's fine, we're happy, now you can go home. You need to start your scenario very, very properly. You need to start out with, hello Miss Smith, my name is Dr. Sharma. I was the medical registrar looking after you while you were in the hospital. We are discharging you today and we're just going to discuss your discharge. So you need to start off your conversation by doing this. A lot of people, they say, good morning, my name is this, or how are you today? What brings you to the hospital today? I won't really advise using good morning, because the patient might be dying, okay? So use terms like hello, my name is this. Remember guys, if you need to understand your scenario and you need to understand your situation. For people who are asking, we're going to be putting this video on YouTube, on our YouTube channel, so don't worry about it. Just try and just try and go through what I'm talking about now. We'll put everything on YouTube, and but you need to concentrate on what I'm saying, because then you can ask questions if you have. Let me just quickly update this. All right. So you need to understand your scenario and your situation. You need to know where you are. So you need to know, am I in a clinic? Am I in a ward? Am I in the emergency department? So you need to know, because what a lot of people do is that the patient is being discharged, and then because their mind is sort of tailored to that and they've memorized a few sentences, they'll ask, what brings you to the hospital today? Guys, this is very bad. This patient is someone who was in your ward, and then you walk to them and told them what brings them to the hospital today. This would make the examiner think that, one, you did not read your task properly. Two, maybe you don't even know English and you've sort of memorized some sentences and you're just repeating them like a parrot. You need to know where you are, and that's how you start your relationship building. Emphasize on the patient's perspective. Sometimes the patient might be in a lot of pain, or the patient might have had a relative who's died, or might have had a relative who's dying, or the patient might have had a very, very bad news. If you tell them things like, oh, good morning, how are you today? I hope you're having a nice day. And they've just been told that they are HIV positive or they've got metastatic cancer, you're going to look very stupid. So you need to emphasize on your patient's perspective. You need to tailor your relationship building, or you need to tailor the start of your conversation to the scenario at hand. For example, if you've had someone who's been recently diagnosed with cancer and they're here for their follow-up, then you can say that, I understand. Hello, Mrs. Smith. My name is Dr. Sharma. I'll be looking after you today. I understand that you haven't had a very good news recently. We'll just try and go through your cancer diagnosis today and try and figure out how we can help you out to the best of our abilities. So just see how I tailored my relationship building to the scenario at hand. And that's how I'm going to score marks on being a good doctor. You need to understand and incorporate your patient's perspective. What they've defined on the OET official site is the impact of how you fully involve the patient in the conversation, and you tailor yourself to your listener's understanding and comfort. What lots of people do is they read the task. I've got a task where I've got a patient who's been diagnosed with a heart attack. All right, I'm going to talk about a heart attack. Okay, I've got some good sentences. A heart attack is cholesterol deposition in your vessels. And so I've made all of my thing. And then I go into the task, and then I stop listening to what the patient is saying, and I go on this long lecture about what a heart attack is, and I didn't really listen to what my patient was saying. You need to make sure that this is not a monologue, this is a dialogue. So what a dialogue means is that there are two people and they are talking. It's not one person giving a lecture. So what might happen during your OET speaking is, if you go on this lecture, the patient might ask you some questions, which you were supposed to get marks on. For example, in this scenario, the patient might say, do you think I'm going to die, doctor? And because you've memorized all of these lines, you didn't really listen to what your patient was saying. And then you keep on talking and talking about treatments and talking about medications. You didn't really listen to what the patient was asking, and you'll score very low marks on your understanding and incorporating your patient's perspective, because that was what OET was testing you for. Sometimes, if they ask you a question, if you have memorized a lot of things, pause, answer their question, and then you go on to your lecture. For example, if I was going on to this, I was telling this patient about a heart attack. Okay, Ms. Smith, we're going to just talk about what a heart attack actually is. So a heart attack is a deposition of a little bit of cholesterol into your heart's arteries, which then get blocked. So the blood supply to your heart is decreased, and then the heart muscle starts to die. And then Ms. Smith asks, doctor, that sounds very dangerous. Do you think I'm going to die? Then I'll pause my lecture, and then I'll say, I understand your concerns. I know it can be quite a frightening diagnosis to have. Heart attack, yes, in some cases might be fatal, but in most cases, we're able to treat it with appropriate medications. So see how I stopped my lecture, and then I'll go on to, okay, so let's just talk a little bit about the treatments that we can offer you. So I know I'm still telling them everything I want to tell them about a heart attack, but I stopped my lecture in between and answered the patient's questions. So just make sure that you're listening to the patient and you're answering their questions. Sometimes I teach my students about what active listening is. So when you're listening to someone, okay, if your friend comes to you and they tell you about what happened to them, for example, they went to this party and the party, something very interesting happened in it, then you react to your friend, okay? So if the patient, if the friend tells you, oh my God, you know what happened in that party yesterday? Then you will tell your friend, really? Is that what happened? So you are responding to what they're telling by using this cue, really? Oh, I can't believe that. Oh my God, is that true? So then your friend knows that you're listening to what they're saying. So that's what we refer to as active listening, reacting to the person's emotions while they're talking to you. For example, if a patient is telling you, oh doctor, you know, I'm so scared, my mother also died of diabetes, she had lots of complications, she had ketoacidosis, I think. So as a doctor, you tell them, oh, I understand, that might be very distressing for you. So you're sort of reacting to their emotions. If the person in front of you is excited, you sort of mirror their excitement. If the person in front of you is distressed, you mirror their distress. So you react to their emotions and you get involved in the conversation this way. Ideas, concerns, and expectations. So this is another concept which I always try to emphasize on people that I'm teaching clinical communication to. I try and emphasize it a little bit more on when people are giving their CBT exams or when they're giving their PACEs. But this is quite important on the OET speaking as well. So ideas, concerns, and expectations are with regards to your patient. Ideas means what the patient already knows. Concerns are what the patient is actually worried about, and expectations are what they want you to do. For example, we'll try and make this a little interactive. I'll try and tell you a scenario, and then you can tell me what you think the patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations are. So I've got this lady. She has been recently diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. She's seen a movie about multiple sclerosis, and the lady who was the heroine, who was the actress who was in this movie, actually got wheelchair bound very soon, and then her family members left her, and then she was left isolated in the world. And that's the main thing that she's worried about, is whether multiple sclerosis now means that she'll have to leave her social life, and then she'll get locked up in a room bound to a chair. And then she just wants to discuss the social support for people with advanced multiple sclerosis. So in this case, I want you guys to type into the chat window what this lady's ideas are, what her concerns might be, and what she would expect from a doctor in front of her explaining multiple sclerosis. So guys, if you go to your chat window, just type out what you think this patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations are. We'll give everyone 2 minutes. I'll put the scenario in the chat window as well in case you forget. So multiple sclerosis, new diagnosis, saw a movie, social isolation. So those were the bullet points that this lady has. I want you to tell me what you think her ideas are, her concerns are, and what her expectations are from this conversation, and how you would try and tailor this conversation to this patient. So we'll give everyone about 2 minutes to think about this. So just start typing in your window. You can send me the message privately if you feel shy, but I want everyone to participate. If you make any mistakes, then it's okay. This is a safe space. You can make as much mistakes as you can. Okay, for people who missed the question, the question is that we're talking about trying and identifying a patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations. So we have a patient who has been diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. She has seen a movie about multiple sclerosis, and the actress, the main lead in this movie, had multiple sclerosis. And she got wheelchair bound very soon, and then her family left her. So she's very scared about the same happening to her. We're trying to identify what we feel this patient's ideas are, what her concerns are, and what her expectations might be regarding this conversation that you're going to have. So we've started getting answers, which is good. We've had someone, Eamon, very nice. They've said she knows that multiple sclerosis can make you wheelchair bound. She's concerned that she might lose her social life and interaction will be restricted. She's expecting either we should counsel her that this is not going to happen, or we should give her an alternative. Excellent answer, Eamon. So This is what we need to know. This is the concept that basic clinical communication should be based on. Now, if this lady comes to you and you're the world's best neurologist and you know everything about multiple sclerosis, and you give this lady a long lecture about the pathophysiology of multiple sclerosis, then this perhaps you'll just you'll just disappoint this person. You need to understand that, all right, so I've got someone who's probably quite traumatized by the diagnosis of multiple sclerosis, because all of her ideas about multiple sclerosis are based on this movie that they've watched. They're probably expecting that the same will happen to them. They don't really know that multiple sclerosis can be either very mild or very severe. So there's a spectrum. But their main concerns is them being affected socially and their life being affected in terms of being able to engage with family and friends. So they won't really be interested if I told them about how it happens or how it affects the brain or how it affects your nerves. They want to know about the social aspect. So that when I speak to this patient, I should probably just focus on the social aspects of having a neurological disorder. Again, taking another example for ideas, concerns, and expectations. Let's try and make this interactive again. I've got another gentleman who's come in with, he's been recently diagnosed with HIV, and he thinks that it's a mild infection, but he's very, very concerned because he comes from a very religious family, and he thinks that he's disappointed his parents by catching this disease, and he feels that you now as a nurse or a doctor will tell everyone that he's got HIV. And this patient has now come to you for a follow-up. And as a doctor, you're supposed to discuss their medications, or as a nurse, you're supposed to discuss their management. What do you think this patient's ideas are, what their concerns are, and what their expectations are from you as a doctor or a nurse counseling this patient on follow-up? I'll give everyone about 2 minutes to answer. So this is someone who has been recently diagnosed with HIV. They think it's a mild disease, but they think they're very concerned about the religious aspect of it, and they think that now it's are going to be disappointed, and that you're going to tell everyone that they've got HIV. Okay, so Mahat has very rightly said that this patient feels ashamed and not aware that his family will know about this. Saira has said, counseling him about disease spread and management and empathize his condition. So Saira, that's right. Those are his expectations. Matty has said idea HIV. So Matty, his idea is actually that HIV is a mild disease?
Yes.
Ghulam has said he knows that he has acquired HIV infection, which is not good for him due to his religious background, so he's ashamed of it. Okay. Sahila has said, idea is that he knows it's a mild infection. Sahila, that's right. Concerns about religious views, and he feels about parents because they feel something bad. That's right. Expectations, we need to explain confidentiality and management about medication. Excellent, Sahila. So Sahila told us, which was very correct, that if a patient is concerned about the religious aspect of HIV and they think that you as a doctor are going to tell everyone that they've got HIV, they definitely be needed to be told about confidentiality. So they need to be reassured through this conversation that HIV is a confidential diagnosis. So you don't really reveal a patient's medical diagnosis to everyone. If you reassure the patient that this is going to happen, then your job of telling them about the medications for this patient will become very, very easy. So guys, you need to understand what the patient wants, and then you need to organize your conversation around the patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations. Excellent. Moving on, there's another thing that I want people to understand is you need to pick up a patient's cues. This happens loads of time on OET speaking. It happens a lot on your MRCP, PLAB, and your CBT as well. You need to pick up what the patient is saying. For example, the patient might give you clues. They might do things like, oh no, oh my God, what's happening? Oh dear. So all of these are indications that the patient is distressed. But if you're very focused on giving a lecture, or you're not really actively looking at the patient or listening to that patient, you're going to miss these cues. And then you might look like a rude doctor or a nurse who doesn't really care about the patient's emotions. Sympathy and empathy don't mean saying sorry again and again. Sympathy means mirroring your patient's emotions. If they're sad, you're supposed to be thoughtful about it. So remember, you need to pick up your patient's cues. All right. Another thing which is assessed on your OET speaking is whether you provided them a structure. What they have defined it on the official site is the impact of how you organize the information you provide and introduce the topics for your listeners' understanding. Guys, just remember, the task has a lot of sections in it. So, for example, if you have a task which talks about a patient who's, so you're a GP and you've got a patient who's been recently admitted to an A&E with acute exacerbation of asthma. Now they come to you as a follow-up after that, and your task would probably be that you make a note of this A&E admission, talk about medication compliance, and arrange follow-up. So your task will have parts. So you need to show the OET examiners that you are structuring your conversation. What that means is that you're going to first start by talking about the patient's A&E admission. You stop that, then you talk about the medications that you're taking, then you stop that, and then you talk about the patient's follow-up. You need to divide your conversation into chunks depending upon your task points. So make sure that you read your task very properly, and then when you're organizing your thoughts before beginning your speaking, you put in bullet points. So this is my number one topic that I'll talk about, this is my number two topic that I'm going to talk about, and this is my number three topic that I'm going to talk about. Lots of people, they do this, is that they jump from one topic to another. So what they'll do is, because they haven't really signposted in their mind that this is my number one, this is my number two, this is my number three, they'll start with, okay, now I'm going to talk about your medications. Remember, you got admitted in A&E, you need to go to your follow-up. So I'm going from one thing to another and then jumping back again. So then I'm not going to score marks in my organization structure. And this is a technique which I often teach my students, especially if they're giving paces. You need to signpost changes in topic. So what you need to do is, when you're jumping from one thing to another, you need to tell your patient that you're jumping or you're changing the subject. This is especially important when you give your PLAB exams and you give your you take history. So you'll go from your present history of presenting illness, and then you go on to your past medical history. At the point where you jump from the history of presenting complaints to your past medical history, you need to signpost to the patient that you're jumping subject. So you'll say, okay, now I'm going to talk about your present illness. So just let me know what brought you to the hospital today, what was going on. Then the patient sort of told you what was going on, and then they stopped, and then you say, all right, now I'm just going to ask you a few questions about your past medical history. So you signposted the change in topic. Going back to our example of the patient who came in with asthma, you can ask them, all right, Ms. Smith, first of all, we're just going to discuss your recent attendance in A&E. Thank you for telling me about your attendance. Now I'm just going to talk a little bit about the medications that you're taking for your asthma. We'll just go through the medications and see how we can manage your asthma properly. All right, now that we've talked about your medications, I'm just going to go through the follow-up plan for your asthma in the future to make sure that we take care of you now. So that's how you signpost your changes in topic, and that's how your structure looks good. What I find is, when I signpost changes in topic, I often go back to just making sure that the patient has an opportunity to ask you questions. For example, if I was talking about the A&E attendance, I'm going to ask them, all right, I think you've told me a lot about your A&E visit. I'm just going to now discuss the medications that you need for your asthma. But before we do that, is there anything you would like to add or anything you would like to ask me with regards to your A&E attendance? So by providing a structure, I won't really miss anything else that the patient wants to tell me. It might happen that the patient might say, oh, doctor, I mean, this A&E visit has left me so scared. So at that point, you show them your empathy and you show them your sympathy. I'm sorry that this was a very scary situation for you. Let's just go through your medications now and try and manage your medications now so that this doesn't happen in the future. So see how beautifully I tried to tailor my task. So I was trying to do my job, and I'm still going to do what I was supposed to do, but I made the patient feel that I cared about them, and now my conversation is more interesting to them because I've tailored my conversation to their needs. I've tailored my conversation to the fact that they're scared, and now I'm trying to emphasize that, okay, you're scared, but what we're doing is going to help you. So now the patient is actually listening to me as well. So this is very good if you can provide a structure to your conversation. Nurses and doctors, all of you, when you're going to come and work in a foreign country, if you provide a structure to your conversation, people are going to listen to you better. And as nurses and as doctors, you'll be able to take care of your patients better. So this exam, I actually love the clinical communication aspect because this teaches you so much about coming and working in a foreign country. Information gathering. On the OET speaking, they assess your ability to gather information. So what it's defined on the official website is the impact of the questions that you ask, and you tailor your response to your listener's understanding. A basic technique which you need in this section to pass is moving on from open to closed questions. Doctors and nurses, when you get taught basic history taking, if you're talking about, for example, if you're talking about pain, you always move from, all right, so tell me a little bit more about your pain. And then the patient tells you a little bit more. Can you tell me where exactly is the pain? So the patient will tell you, okay, I've got epigastric pain. Then you'll ask them a little more close question. Does the pain radiate to your back? So you started out with, tell me a little bit about your pain, to does the pain radiate through your back? So it's moving on from open to closed questions. And that's basic history taking that every medical college student or every nurse knows. So use the same in your OET. So you move on from, okay, can you tell me a little bit more about your A&E visit? When were you admitted? Did the what treatments were you given? Were you given any intubation or were you given any nebulizers? So that's how you're moving from your open to your closed questions. Sometimes they might trick you on the OET and they'll give you some vague statements. Oh, doctor, the ward that I was admitted in, it had so many advanced things. So this is a very vague statement. So we're going to ask them, oh, can you tell me a little bit more about this? So you have to clarify your vague statements. Again, I teach a lot of students that you need to summarize your information. So when you've sort of taken a history, then you repeat everything that the patients told you. One, that's going to just show the examiners that you know paraphrasing. So whatever the patient told you, you were able to repeat the same into your own sentences. You're going to score very high on your linguistic criteria. And then, like we said on the signposting part, you can invite them for correction or further information. So once you've summarized your thing, then you ask them, is there anything you would like to add? Or is there anything you would like to correct? So that's something that you can do. That's a good sentence that you can use on your OET speaking. So once you've summarized the whole thing the patients told you, then you tell them, okay, is there anything else you would like to add? So that looks very good. And then you score a lot on your information gathering section. All right. Information giving. So just know that on the OET, you are assessed on the quality of information you provide. So you need to tailor your information to what your patient already knows. So same ideas, concerns, and expectations. And just be prepared for changes. So the patient might tell you, doctor, I don't want to listen to this. Can you tell me this? So even though your task said something, your patient might throw you a curveball. So just be prepared when you're giving information. Again, I keep on emphasizing that sympathy is not saying sorry again and again. It's tailoring your conversation to your patient. So just remember that. I'll try and do another session next week where we'll try and make full sentences that we can use on OET speaking and try and make our speaking life a little easy. by memorizing some sentences that might be useful for some people. So we'll do it next Saturday where we'll discuss this further. All right, now we'll do some solved examples. In the next, we'll do three solved examples. We'll give you a sample scenario and then I'll ask you a few questions. And then everyone, you can type in on your chat window. You can type in on your chat window whatever you want to include. All right. So for people who want to leave, what we'll do is we'll upload this on YouTube as well. So if you are going back to work, just you won't miss anything. This session is going to end in the next 15-20 minutes. So if you're leaving for work, we'll upload this on YouTube tomorrow so you can go through the samples then. Sushma has asked about official website. So Sushma, that's the official OET website that we're talking about. All right, so this is the scenario that we have. Let me pull the other. So this is the scenario. What I want you to do is tell me how will you introduce yourself to this patient? How will you do relationship building for this patient? I want you to give me full sentences that you would use when you enter the room and start speaking to the person in front of you. So we're doing the relationship building and trying to form full sentences, and we have to introduce ourselves to the person in this scenario. So I'll give everyone about 3 minutes to do this. So I want everyone to tell me, how will you introduce yourself to this, to the person in front of you? All right, so we've started getting answers. Lots of people have said that they would say, "Hello, Matthew, how are you doing today?" Guys, just remember there is no sun in this scenario that you're speaking to. You're actually speaking to the parent. So you need to introduce yourself to the parent. So you're going to say, hello, my name is, whatever you want to say your name is. My name is Dr. Smith. Or my name is Nurse Smith. I will be taking care of Matthew today. Can I ask your name, please? So you're going to ask the mom's name. And then she'll tell you, okay, my name is Samantha. Then you can ask them, how can I address you? And then she'll say, you can call me Sam. Lots of people have said, hello, mom. We do that sometimes when we are working as in pediatrics. Then we do say, hello, mom. But what I would suggest on the OET, don't call the parent mom. You can say, hello, my name is Mr. Johnson. I'm the treating doctor today. Are you Matthew's mother or father? How can I address you today? So just remember, guys, especially for people who thought that the person in front of them was Matthew, you need to read your scenario and you need to understand who the person in front of you is. It can get very, very confusing, especially because the person in front of you looks perfectly healthy and then the scenario says something else. It's very difficult in simulated circumstances to remember, but just make a note of when you get your scenario, just make a note, person I am speaking to, and then you just write who this person is. So you write their role, parent, patient, carer, father. So just know who the person in front of you is. Simranjeet has said she would write, hello, mom. I know you must have gone through a very stressful life situation as Matthew was ill. Simranjeet, that's fine, but make sure that you tell them your name and ask them their name before you start talking about, I know you must have gone through a very stressful situation. Bakar has said, hello, ma'am. How is he doing? Today, is there any asthmatic bout? So, Bakar, what you did is that you sort of jumped very quickly to the asthmatic bout. Stop. Ask. Tell them your name. Ask them their name. And then you talk about, I know it can be quite stressful. And then you move about, I'm going to talk about the asthmatic bout that this patient had. Abdullah has said, hi, my name is Abdullah. I will be taking care of you. Dola, please remember, you're not taking care of the parent, you're taking care of the child. Okay, so I will be taking care of your child today. Okay, and then you've said, can you tell me your name? You have to write, can you please tell me your name? Komal has said, hello, my name is Doctor. How can I help you today? Komal, please ask the person in front of you, how can I address you? And then ask, how can I help you today? So guys, lots of people are making loads of mistakes on relationship building. This is something that everyone messes up. So please make sure after we finish today's scenario is that you tell us before starting any scenario what you would address or how would you start this conversation. Simranjeet has asked, even if we know the patient as she's coming to the same clinic. Simranjeet, even though this patient might be coming to the same clinic, they might give you a name already, but throughout the conversation, even if in real life, even if you know the patient, you need to be reminded of their name. So what you can do is you can say, is that Miss Smith? Or how can I address you? There's nothing wrong with asking them their name again. But because this is a patient, even with real patients, you need to ask them their name before starting out. Bakar, what you can do is sometimes people do get confused with this. He's asked, since the patient came 2 days ago, if I did not ask them the name or call them their name directly, you can assume their name, or before you start the conversation, you can ask the interlocutor, does this person have a name? And then you can address them directly by the name. Some people have tried that in their actual exam and it's worked. Sometimes the interlocutor might not give you a name. So just try and assess, ask them their name. And then if the interlocutor doesn't give you a name, then just say, is that Miss Smith? Hema has said, can you please let me know your good name? Again, Hema, this is not a proper English. This is not proper English. This is something that's a local dialect, asking about good name, because it's a direct translation of Shubh Naam, which is a Hindi word. So you're supposed to say, can you please let me know your name? Just cut the good out of it. All right, moving on. So this is actually a role player card. So why I've included that in this session is, this is what the scenario is given to the interlocutor as. So you can see that they've given a number of concerns that the patient has to, or the parent has to ask the nurse. Okay, what I want you to do is, on this example, I want you to tell me what are this patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations. So on the example on the screen, this is the role player card. This is not the speaking scenario. This is actually something which is given to the parent, or the person who's pretending to be the parent. Through this scenario, I want you to tell me what your ideas, concerns, and expectations are as a doctor or as a nurse. What I want everyone to do is type in the chat window what you think this patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations are. All right, so Mahad has said, idea is she's annoyed and worried about her child and wants immediate evaluation. Shushma has said, mother and child are agitated. She expects a doctor to address them immediately, or a nurse to make it possible. Gulam has said, concerns are regarding acute attack of asthma. And Simarjeet has said, idea to confirm about the child's condition. Now, in this case, everyone's given a good answer. So that's good job, guys. This patient's, the main focus when this scenario would happen is that, because this parent is so fixated on seeing the doctor, their expectations are centered on seeing a doctor or the nurse making them see a doctor immediately. They want the nurse to address that. So your scenario will be tailored around pacifying this parent, tailoring to their ideas that asthma is very scary. So you're supposed to tell them, I can understand that you're very anxious because your child has asthma. I am sorry that you have to wait. While we're waiting, I can answer some of your questions, but I will make sure that your child is seen by the doctor. So the ideas were that asthma is scary. The concerns were that they were concerned about their child and they wanted the doctor to see them immediately. And the expectations were that this nurse makes the doctor come and take the come and get the doctor soon. So if you understand your scenario in terms of ideas, concerns, and expectations, you will be able to solve this scenario clearly. Some people, the nurse might get very scared and then she might keep repeating, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, again and again. And then the parent will make your life very difficult. But if as a nurse, you're able to manage that expectation, you're able to tell them, I'm going to make sure that the doctor sees you as soon as possible. Once you say that, then the parent will start cooperating with you. So that's how ideas, concerns, and expectations can be used to make your life easier as a nurse or as a doctor. So two concepts that I've tried to emphasize on this session is one, which is relationship building. You need to understand how you're going to begin your conversation. And two, you need to understand what the patient's ideas, concerns, and expectations are. So we're now reaching the end of our session. I know it's been quite a long session. I'm sorry, guys. But we just wanted to emphasize on the common failing points on the OET speaking and trying to highlight the basic mistakes which people make. The channel's name is Teachio Academy. So it's on the screen. It's the same spelling. On YouTube, it's called Teachio Academy, and the website is teachioacademy.com, and our email address is teachioacademy@gmail.com. So if anyone wants the common medical terms which are commonly mispronounced on the OET, please send me an email. You can email me on teachioacademy@gmail.com. Please send me your email address on the email address that I've given, because it's very difficult for me to compile a list. You're just sending me your email addresses in the chat window. Just to compile the list, it's easier for me to, if you email me your address, and then we can send you the common medical terms which are mispronounced on OET speaking. If you have any doubts, we'll try and cover them in our next session. So I'll try and do a session next week about OET speaking. If for people who don't know, we have an OET writing webinar with Mr. Manoj Sharma, who's an OET expert. He's an English teacher and quite experienced with dealing with students on the OET and IELTS. He's going to cover OET writing and common grammar errors and common language errors that people make on the OET writing. For people who are still sending me their email addresses, if you can email me your request at teachioacademy@gmail.com, I can send you the PDF with the commonly mispronounced medical terms. Please don't send me your email addresses in the chat window. Please email me your email addresses. So tomorrow we'll have a session with Mr. Manoj Sharma just to cover OET writing. I would strongly recommend you to attend that session. But thank you guys for joining us. Thank you for participating. You've been a great audience, and we'll make sure that we keep helping you in the future. It's going to be on the same time And you can get the link for joining on your WhatsApp groups. So just text on the WhatsApp group if you want the session link. Sushma, it's going to be on the same time, which is 11 o'clock British Standard Time. So the same time the session was started. So just make sure that you correlate with your country times. All right, guys, thank you so much for joining. Good luck on your OET. Sushma, if you just text 447-401-554-663, we can text you the link to join the session tomorrow. All right, good luck, guys. I hope you do well. Just don't make the mistakes that I've told you. I'll see you next Saturday.